Yes, I apologize, you will have to admit that I'm Ubina. Although this talk will be more focused on chemistry than probably she would have given you a much more urbanized view on Jerash and the whole project. So I apologize for that in advance. But this is a project we've done together. So Ubina and Akim Lichtenberger are the directors of this big excavation in Jerash that's been going on since 2011. And we became involved in the glass studies. So me and Ian Freestone looking at the chemistry of the glass, and Holger Schwarzer have been looking at the typology. And so in that way, we have kind of tried to cover all angles to try to understand the glass that came into Jerash. Jerash, and I really wish Rubina could introduce Jerash, but it's at the eastern end of the Roman Empire, and then when the Byzantine Empire, Islamic, becomes an integrated part of that. But in 704, there's an earthquake, and that's the end of the city, so that's also the end of the story of the glass. It's a big temple area. And here are some of the temple, but what they chose to do was to work in one of the more areas away from the temples to look at, hopefully, what they were hoping was the more domestic settings. So not the glass used for the big temples, but maybe the glass used also in the households. And this is what it looks like. So you may not guess it, but there will be fantastic house structures and baths and things like that, cisterns for water under this. And so here is Jerash with the city wall, looking exactly like the Millennium Falcon. But it actually isn't. It's actually two hills coming down, and then there's a river, the Vardi, that runs down in the middle, and then it runs through the city gates on either side. And their area, the one, so here the big temple area, this is now all occupied by the city, so there's no access to the ruins on that side. And here is the area with the domestic houses away from the big temples. So a little bit about the stories is there is fine from the Stone Age, very little from the Hellenistic period, although we find glass from this period. And then the city really blossoms in the Byzantine and in the Islamic period until the earthquake wipes it out. And after that, there's a little bit of settlement in that area from the Mamluks. One of the contacts that they have, or the most fantastic contacts they have, is when the earthquake hit, there are these houses that are preserved, and they have this house in particular have the most fantastic finds. So not just here are the glass, but also metal and this gold bead necklace, lots of jewelry, but otherwise not as rich houses as this one. And this is right before the earthquake. And I'll come back to that because we also find some really interesting glass types in this particular house, whereas we find the more common glass types in the other areas that they have excavated. And they've excavated a lot of trenches within this area. And so what we chose to do was to, actually Holger chose out a selection that would include the most typical of the typology. And it turned out that the typology was Byzantine and early Icelandic. And that's what we did the glass analysis on. And this formed the basis for a very big study that we have then been working on since then. And there's just to show what I couldn't see, that this is a cosmetic flask. So these typologies. Okay, so at the time, and I don't have to go through this, but of course we had the production in Egypt and we had the production at the Levantine coast with the different types of glasses coming from the different factories. And so we didn't only want to see what the provenance of the glass was, we also wanted to understand the inner city, inner workings of the city. So what can we say about the recycling? What can we say about the types of fuels they use, because they would all contaminate the glass, the furnace with the plate, like we showed for Riva a little bit, and also contamination from blow types, pipes and tools. So basically understand that. And this seems to be a very big thing. So we did electron microscope analysis and ICP analysis for the trace element. And here I just want to point out Steve, because Steve is actually the student who was working on the late context in Riva. So here she's not working on Gerasa glass, she is actually working on paper glass. And the results were that we find, so here are just the different groups from Cheville and Freestone. And what we see is mostly different time or 11 time glasses. We also see Roman glass and a couple of Hellenistic glasses in the selection we had. We can now say from the big selection that this represents really well what it is. There's lots of Byzantine glass, there's also quite a bit of Roman glasses in the Roman context, and then there are some exotic glass types that comes right in the end. And it fits also the strontium isotopes, which we did. We have one here antimony glass from Egypt, and it also had a different strontium isotopic composition, so that was showing that it's from a different sands than the ones along the Levantine coast. And we saw lots of signs of recycling. So it seems that Jerash really was a town, even in the Roman glass we also see, but this is for the Byzantine glass that was reusing the glass. And I forgot to say that the Byzantine glass is coming from Abalonia, so it has the chemical signature of Abalonia. And we see a very strong correlation between potassium and phosphorus coming from remelting the glass. We also see that elements that are related to the raw materials in the glass, they have a very low coefficient of variation, whereas colorants, so mixed in colored glass in the remelting, shows a very big variations within these glass. And we know that there was a lot of recycling for, because we see in the Artemis temple that under the stairs, there were just these piles of glass, but here they've been collecting the glass, taking them back probably to recycle. And this is a photo of this glass from Daniela Bandoni, so she's working on that glass. So it's a little bit away from the northwest quarter that we were working in, but it's just showing that there was a very systematic system where they collected the glass and remounted it. Here, this is a experimental study by Painter where she is, oh, I see that some of the elements are missing. I don't know why, but it's just showing the different contaminants you get in the glass from the different components. So from the ash, for instance, this should have said calcium, phosphorus, and potassium. And from the clays, you get alumina, titanium, and iron. And from the rhodite, of course, iron. And what we see in the Byzantine glass, along with the contamination of phosphorus, is we also see potassium, but we don't see an increase in calcium. And this seems to be significant for what kind of fuels they were using in their remelting ovens. And that also disappeared. How interesting, it must be a PC Mac thing. But in Umeltimau, there's a study also of these Apollonia type Byzantine glasses where they see a buildup of potassium, calcium, and phosphorus. Whereas in Jerash, we only see a buildup of potassium and phosphorus. So it seems like there were use of two different fuels in the two towns when they remelted the glasses. And this would be a very typical wood fuel where you have a lot of calcium in the wood ash glass. And we were trying to figure out what this fuel could be where you don't have a buildup of calcium. And so we looked at, since the Northwest Quarter was studied from all angles, Pernille Bangsgaard was looking at the kind of animals they had. So we tried to look in these databases for different fuels or different ash compositions of bones from sheep and goat and pigs and cow. And that actually has a lot of calcium. We also looked at the different trees that medieval hell has been observed. And so the oak, olive, and pine nut tree will also result in contamination of calcium from the fuel ash. But one thing that does not do it is olive pits and pulp So if you take the remnants of your olive oil production, use it as a fuel, that might be what could result in low potassium calcium. And this was kind of a fantastic observation for us to see that since we know there are lots of olive presses in Jerash, that they were using a different fuel. So the question is, of course, why did they, we know that they changed the fuel, so it used to be that there was calcium in the contamination from the fuel ash. Is it because they're looking for a cheaper fuel to keep up demand? Is it because they ran out of wood? That is, of course, an open question. But for the newest study we looked at, we actually found some more of the glass types. So in the house that was hit by the earthquake, we see Egypt 1 glasses, we see plant ash glasses from east. So it seems like there were a lot of trade routes that were open to Jerash. And the reason we don't see them before the earthquake is maybe Jerash didn't open up in the Byzantine time, or because they were easy to get glass from the Levant coast. Or maybe it's because when they did get them and they broke, they put them back in the recycling piles, and then of course the signatures disappears. So we don't know that. But they're there. There is glass coming from the south, and there is glass coming from the east, but we can only see it in the context that was so abruptly stopped. So I hope I lived up to Obina and what she would have said. I know she would have said it differently, but I hope so. Thank you.